success. But many believed their accomplishments were a result of luck. And in some cases, they even believed that they got into an excellent institution or they got a great job as a result of some clerical error. You know, maybe Yale lost their paperwork and for some reason let me in. The study also noted clinical symptoms that commonly accompany imposter syndrome. Some of those are generalized anxiety, lack of self-confidence, depression, and frustration caused by not being able to meet one's own impossibly high standards. Clients and I have also highlighted four contributing factors to the phenomenon. They first outlined two common family dynamics that the subjects experienced as children. The first was being considered sensitive or charming compared to a more intelligent sibling. That children in this case used to work really hard to try to prove their families wrong, and their families usually remained relatively unimpressed. And so they constantly struggle between, seeking validation and the fear that maybe their family is right and they're not as smart as they think. And on the other hand, there's the problem of being considered perfect or effortlessly talented. These children were often told that they had an innate ability and that perfection comes easily to them. So then when they did find themselves struggling with anything, they thought of that as, proof that they're not all that they've been propped up to be. Everything you're doing should be perfect. If not, then who are you really? The researchers also laid out some societal factors that can contribute to the phenomenon. First, they cited other research claiming that women are more likely than men to have low expectations for success in many tasks. Our expectations color the way that we view our experiences. So when a person experiences unexpected success, they're more likely to attribute it to an external, temporary cause like luck. Whereas if someone experiences expected success, they're more likely to attribute that to a more permanent, stable cause like ability. Additionally, research at the time pointed to low expectations of women by society at large. And all of these factors converge to what we now refer to as imposter syndrome. Clients and I have also recommended several therapies for their clients. One is group therapy with other high achievers experiencing the imposter phenomenon. First, this allows clients to see that they were not alone. And also, it might be easier to recognize the intelligence and talent in someone else and then see that disconnect between their skills and their self-perception. Another suggested therapy was to work on interrupting ritualistic behaviors. For example, when studying for a test, try thinking, I will do well on this exam instead of, I may fail. The goal here is to start to interrupt that expectation of failure so that you can start to feel those feelings of expected success. This success came from something consistent in who I am. I thought this was an interesting one. The idea here is to think of the people that you believe you have fooled, and then imagine confessing to them how you caused them. Next, imagine out loud how each person would respond to this news. The authors gave a few examples. I did not give you an award in English because you charmed me.
is too modern and doesn't discuss any of our genders. It's also important to note that, obviously, coming from a white perspective, the researchers were white and almost all of the participants were white. In the late 1970s, there was a movement to study gender psychology, and there was a movement to study race psychology. But those two things were combined until 1980.
acceptable.
You found the need to be the best. Many imposters were underachieving as children. They felt compelled to compete with others in new situations and continue to surround themselves with other smart and talented people. You're described as a perfectionist. We imposters often hold ourselves to impossible standards of perfection. Anything short of that is considered a failure. The fear of failure can paralyze you. How many of you have ever opted not to try something in order to avoid the possibility of failing? A few of us, most of us. You avoid showing confidence. This one tends to be more common in people from marginalized genders. This can come from either a fear of appearing to overcompensate, or a fear of appearing to fail, not being able to measure up to expectations. You actually dread success. Not feeling worthy of success can lead to feelings of guilt when you're acknowledged or praised for it. You compare your struggles and obstacles to those of others. Everyone compares themselves to other people, but imposters constantly tell themselves that everyone else is getting by with fewer struggles in life than they are. You associate praise with charm over actual talent. Because people with imposter syndrome are typically highly intelligent and good at interacting with others, people will often find them charming. But that is easy to associate
I'm curious whether folks answered this question about sort of how it feels to be talking about these things. I think my hope is not that in hearing other people's stories we can start to resonate with and relate to one another. Here, let's get back into it. Thank you.
Did you contradict? Impostor Syndrome.